We want to get started with our first speaker, our first keynote. Our first keynote speaker is a global business celebrity, a primetime television and radio show host, best-selling author, sought-after keynote speaker, and sometime cowboy. He's a leading business expert, cited in Forbes, Success, Mashable, Marketing Week, and Chief Executive, among many others. He shares his executive insight and commentary on television networks like Bloomberg, MSNBC, Fox Business, equal opportunity commentator, and C-Suite TV. He is a former Bloomberg contributing editor and primetime host and has appeared as a guest celebrity judge on NBC's Celebrity Apprentice with Donald Trump for 3 seasons. He interviews business executives, leaders, and innovators live on stage with interviews being recorded in front of live audiences. So no take two. Please welcome to the stage, Chairman of the C-Suite Network, Jeff Hayzlett.
Hey, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Jenna, we're going to have to, you have a clicker, guys? Thanks. We're going to have to get you to come over to C-Suite TV and join C-Suite TV. Is that, I'm going to drop that down maybe to help a little bit, get some echo. We're okay? Good. How you like my opening so far? Pretty damn good. Okay, let's just get this Trump thing out of the way. Okay, I was a judge. I did help get the show off the ground for 3 seasons. He is a friend of mine. Let's be clear, he is batshit crazy, okay? Yeah. All right? But you should also get used to calling me Ambassador Hayzlett very soon, so. It's all right. No, really, seriously, Trump is helping women. Yes, you're marching against him all over the place, bringing you together. It's just awesome. Come on. Oh, this, lighten up, people. This is funny shit right here. This is broadcast. Trump will be tweeting in a few minutes. It'll be great. Yeah, it'll be fun. It'll be fun. You know, I'm from South Dakota. Anyone here from South Dakota? Never is, but I always like to ask that question. Now, this is what we'd call population density right here in this room. You'd be like the fifth largest city in South Dakota right here. I'm not shitting. You really would be. It's a true story. You know, being with you, and I'm so glad I've been watching Katie build this business over the last 4 years as I've been doing the stuff that we've been doing with C-Suite TV and C-Suite Network. We're going to give you an opportunity to make each of you that are qualified a free member. We're going to do that today, so make sure you stop by and see us today. We'd like to give you a free membership and have more women in the C-suite. It's absolutely deplorable that we even have to have a conversation about gender. It's absolutely bullshit. I am a C-suite 100 officer, have been one. 75% of the people that used to work for me were people of color or women that reported to me. And today, when you look at boards of directors, less than 17% of corporate boards are comprised of women. That is bullshit. And I don't know if you saw yesterday, the defiant girl that was put up in front of the wall, bull, freaking awesome. I just think it's one of the best things. I've been tweeting about it to my followers. I got about 600,000, so I've been like trying to really just play it up because I just think it's wonderful. You know, to be with you and to be a man in front of this audience, I want to thank you for allowing a few of us to squeeze in, okay? You know, but to be with you reminds me of the first time I met my wife's great-grandmother. Now, my wife, grandmother, is the matriarch of the family, and she is this tiny, petite little woman. My wife is 5'1", 105 pounds. I'm 6'3", 200 and some odd pounds. And Grandma Agnes is even smaller than Tammy at 4'11". And when I first met her, she looked up at Tammy, and she looked way up at me, and she looked at Tammy, and she looked way up at me, and she turned back to Tammy and said, "Isn't he bigger than necessary?" So I think that's kind of a theme here today. Let me talk to you a little bit about driving change, because I think you need to be louder. You need to be, if we use a term that many women use, you need to be bitchier, okay? And I say that with all great affection. You need to be bigger in the way in which that you put forth the agenda that you have to drive. You got nothing to lose. You want to keep it going the same way it's been going for so long? You know, driving change isn't easy. I used to be the chief marketing officer of Eastman Kodak. I stepped away from that company 7 years ago. And every single day when I'm doing remotes from wherever I'm at in the country, I'm sitting in a little room looking at a camera, talking to someone 2,000 or 3,000 miles away with a little earpiece, and someone always asks me, what went wrong with Kodak? Why did they go bankrupt last year? And I tell people they didn't go bankrupt last year. They actually went bankrupt back in 1975. It just took this long to catch up. In 1975, a gentleman by the name of Steve Sasson sat in a room and he built the very first digital camera. It was a blue box about this big. I know it to be that because it sat on my desk so that I could use it as a reminder to everybody for not driving change. Now, in that cold December night, he took a photograph of his daughter, a real photograph, put it on the table, took the digital camera, and took the very first digital photograph. Now imagine what it was like to go to executive after executive and say, look, I've changed the way we're going to do photography. I've changed the way we're doing Kodak moments. This is a different way in which we're going to proceed into the future. And every single executive said, no, put it away. They said, we're not in that business. We're in the business of making film. We make this little roll of film that we get about 90% of profit margins off of that little roll, and it goes in a little yellow box that's the most recognizable box and the most recognizable logo in the world. That's what we do. We make film. So don't you mess with the film. They were never in the film business. Think about it. They had the only product that people would actually run back into a burning building to save. If your house was on fire, what would you do? I know that to be true. Back in 2001, my house was struck by lightning in South Dakota. Lightning came through the house and hit me. Yeah, I used to be magnetic, but now I'm electrified. I also plumped up a little bit when I got cooked. That was a lot, like a ballpark Frank. Thank you for those that got that. I think that was good. I thought that was pretty freaking funny, actually. I thought that was. And I don't know if you've ever had lightning hit you, but it hurts. And I'm laying on the ground, and I can't see, and I can't hear. And as I'm waking up, by the way, my neighbor ran over to the house, who's a pathologist. Not cool to wake up and look at a pathologist. He treats dead people, okay? It's not cool. But as I'm waking up, my wife is running by with a box of photographs going, are you okay? Are you okay? That's the product that we had. So I want to talk to you about driving change, to adapt, change, or die. So when we talk about bringing more women into this industry or women into leadership across the entire C-suite, across every business, you will die. Meaning, you're not going to grow unless you start to change and you make it happen. That's what you have to do. And you have to be relentless in this. It's not the lucky who win, it's the relentless. And so I want to talk to you about driving change, not for change's sake. No one gets up in the morning, gets into a car, locks in the steering wheel, locks in the brake, locks in the gas. I'm talking about driving change for a change reason. To continually improve, to change the things that we need to do and know that they need to be better, and we're not going to stop until they happen. So I want to talk to you not about failing fast, because you're going to fail along the way. You're not going to win every battle. But the key is to continue to win and never stop. That's what we want you to do. So I want you to look at think big, act bigger, to become leaders. And it's not easy. You have to learn to become what I call clock changers. When I went to Kodak, I was so excited to go to Kodak. I mean, I'm going to be a Fortune 100 officer. This is like freaking like the lottery when you get at this level. I mean, there's only like 500 of us in the country at that level, in the world, in that level. If you're a Fortune 1000, that's 5,000 officers. There's more people playing professional football in the U.S. than there are Fortune 1000 officers in the country, in the world. So you can tell I'm still excited by this. That or it was those five-hour energy drinks this morning. So I'm on a plane. I jumped on a plane and I flew to Rochester, New York a week early before I passed the urine test or anything, okay? Oh, come on. That's funny shit right there. So I'm on the plane and I'm talking to this 25, 26-year-old gal. I'm trying to get her to ask me what I do because I want to tell her, you know. I'm the chief marketing officer. And so she starts talking about herself, like, yada, yada, yada. Like, I want to hear any of that shit. It was like, blah, blah, blah. She kept talking. And then finally she stopped and she turned to me and she goes, well, what do you do? And I said, well, thank you for asking. You know? And I said, I'm the chief marketing officer of the Eastman Kodak company. And she said, who's that? That's a true story. So I'm a real believer in causing tension, and for all of us to move the agenda forward as much as possible, to take everybody from the center of the room and move them to the edge. You can imagine in a very large company, I'm an HR nightmare. Okay? I'm legal, but I'm an HR nightmare. Because I believe that we've got to drive change, and only through healthy debate, only by being radically transparent and saying the things that we see, can we drive those change. Because if we get comfortable, it's not good. To the extent that I would start calling meetings of my team together when I first got there. I had 7,500 marketing people working for me at the time, $17 billion budget. And I wanted to test the team. So I got to the meeting early. I got up on a chair and I moved the clock ahead by about 20 minutes. So that when people walked in, they'd see the clock, and they'd look at their watch, and they'd look at their phone, they'd look at their watch, they'd say, what time you got? What time you got? And then they'd say, that clock is wrong. That's ridiculous. We have to work in these kinds of conditions. And then they'd start complaining about it, and they'd say, we should do something. And they'd start forming little committees about how they're going to get the clock changed. And someone would know someone in the maintenance department, and they would call and set up an appointment to talk about the clocks. And I'm going like, what? Finally, I said, move ahead. And so day after day after day, same room, same meeting, same people, continually talking about the clock, giving me a task force update on the clock. And finally, I said, why doesn't someone just do something? And a woman got up, and she walked over to the clock, and she put a chair underneath the clock, and she hiked up her dress, and she stood on the chair, and she changed the clock. I named her my chief of staff the very next day. She's running a billion-dollar company. Ladies and gentlemen, that's what leadership is looking for. Clock changers. You just see it and make it happen. Don't ask for permission. Just start changing the frickin' clock. Got it? Give me an amen for Pink Petro. Amen. Oh, brothers and sisters, that was terrible. When I ask you for an amen, I want to hear an amen. You guys sound like a bunch of Lutherans. Lutherans live in constant fear that someplace, sometime, somewhere, someone's having a good time. We're down in Texas. I expect a Baptist amen. If your name's Goldstein or Feinstein, throw in an oy vey, I don't care. Give me an amen.
Amen.
There you go, sisters. Now someone pass the plate. Right now, that's where we go. While we got them going, let me talk to you about driving change as much as, I'm throwing this away. Is that okay with you? I'm just going freestyle. This is fun. How's that? Is that all right? We're going to go old school? All right. Driving change. Why do people fail? Fear. Exactly right. Number one reason that we find that people fail is fear. Why? It's built into the human body. And don't think it's just a woman thing or it's a man thing. Are you kidding me? I went to the bathroom 17 times before I got down here, okay? Fear. Anybody afraid of heights here? I get a nosebleed if I wear two pairs of socks. That's funny shit. Come on, man. I gotta do. All right, fear. For those guys, I'll say it right here. The first time we met that woman across the way and we see her and we walk up to her and she's 5'1", 105 pounds, and 36 years later, she still scares the living shit out of me, okay? Fear. All my life, I wanted to be a cowboy. My father was in the military. We went from Air Force Base to Air Force Base. Year after year, I never got to be a cowboy, but I wanted to be a cowboy. Finally, in my 30s, I said, yes, I'm going to do it. So I went and got the book, Horses for the Dummies. All right? I got the videos. I called people. I decided I'm going to be a cowboy. I'm living in South Dakota. I'm getting some horses. I got two horses. I got the trailer. I got the hat. I got saddles. One for me, my wife, my son, my daughter, and an extra one just in case. And I decided that as I learned to do this, I thought maybe before I take the horses to the ranch for the first time, I should take them to a stables and turn them loose there because I didn't know how to catch them yet, okay? So I took them to his stables and I got the horses out of the trailer and I tied them up to the fence and I'm going to ride the horse for the very first time. Now, I've never done this. I've been to like maybe a retreat or something like this where I'd gone on a horse ride on a horse named like Diablo or something, but wasn't the same. And here I am, I'm going to ride the horse. And so I do what the book says and I get the saddle blanket. I put the saddle blanket on Jay and I get it on Jay and then he kicks it off and then I pick it up and I'm holding on. I grab the saddle, I throw it on, the stirrup goes underneath, I wrap that out. Then I get the cinch belt, I put that underneath, I tie it, this is awesome. Now he's trying to bite me and I'm trying to hold him off. And by the way, never punch a horse in the head. It really hurts you, okay? And just letting you know that, okay? And I find out later he hasn't been ridden in 7 years, so now I understand why I'm having the problems. And so I get the cinch belt on, and I'm thinking, whoa, that looks good. And then he bucks, and the saddle goes whoosh underneath him. And now I twist it up in the blankets, and I'm trying to do that, and he's still biting me. And so I get the bridle. I try to put the bridle on. He doesn't like his ears touched, and I'm trying to slide his ear through the different straps, and I put the bit upside down wrong, and he's spitting it out, and this is not going good. But I want to be a cowboy. So I look around, and 60 yards away was this small, petite, 13 or 14-year-old young girl. And I remember walking up to her with my hat. And I stood before her, and I said, would you help me saddle my horse? If you're going to be a maestro, you got to learn to play a lot of bad notes. In the things that you're going to do to drive change, you're going to fail. You're going to make mistakes. It's going to be uncomfortable. It's going to be fearful. That's the way it's supposed to be. You're human. When you're standing on the high dive, 6 feet off the water, and it looks like 3,000 feet, I don't want to jump. And I have that moment where I want to go back and get off of that high dive. But I can't because there's two people coming up the ladder that are going to push me off, right? So you jump. One, two, wow, I want to do this again. So as you start to grab things that are going to be different for you, and ladies and gentlemen, I've bought and sold over 250 businesses in my career, $25 billion. I'm from a state that most people only know on a map. And I experience that fear every day, every moment. But man, I want to do it again. Risk. Actually, I want to get to risk. I'll finish that last. Radical transparency. One of my shows that I do called C-Suite TV used to be a primetime show on Bloomberg. I've taken it off of Bloomberg, put everything on digital because I'm changing the way that digital TV is being done. In fact, next week I'll announce that C-Suite TV will be in every single airport in the country. Will be the business channel, which no one's ever heard yet. Thank you. And we'll be in every hotel room as well. So this is another way that we're expanding. We're taking our shows where the people are, because that's where you are. When was the last time you rushed home to watch a primetime business show? Right? Exactly. Thank you very much for that, by the way. So I'm watching. So the premise of my show is the C-suite, where I take you into places where 99% of the people who work for the company never get to go, in the C-suite. Because I've had the privilege of being in there, I know what the conversation's like. They're not that exciting, but sometimes it's kind of interesting to see what goes on. I want to take people in there and show you what it's like and experience it like I have experienced it. And so I see things like, you know, like what are the cool things that when you're in TV, they give you stuff. Like I wrote about Diet Mountain Dew, how much I like Diet Mountain Dew. I used to, now I don't do it anymore, but I used to. And so Pepsi sent me a truckload of Diet Mountain Dew. So now I write about Mercedes and Rolexes and things like that. You know, so it's like, cool. Well, Cadillac gave me an Escalade to use in the show, and I'm driving it one day, and holy shit, this is a badass car. I'm going like, whoa, this ain't like my mom's car. This ain't like my mom's Cadillac, right? This is a badass car. How can they be a luxury brand? Hey, wait a second. That's not right. They were like my grandfather's Cadillac, and now they got this Cadillac, and it doesn't make sense because they're in a bankrupt company, in a bankrupt city, so let's go talk to them. So, but one day I'm watching the show, watching the television, and on the TV comes a commercial that says, our pizza tastes like cardboard. You see that commercial? Huh? It's Domino's commercial. Come on, you people aren't making eye contact with me. Oh, thank you. All right. And it's a Domino's commercial, and I said, who the hell spends money to say we suck on TV? And I'm thinking, what was the premise? What was it like sitting around the room and they're in the C-suite and they're all talking about how great they are and someone says, nope, hold it, we suck. And we suck so much we should change our name, retool the pizza recipe, and then we should tell people that we used to suck a lot and you should try us again. And the chairman agreed with him, okay? All right, this is what happened. So I went and saw them, and I said, we reenact. And then I said, listen, Mr. Chairman, is this really how it happened? Yes. Jeff, the CMO, raised his hand, said that, boom, boom, boom. I said, then you spent $10 million to retool pizza, the recipe, world-class chefs, different ingredients, change it, change the name. You changed the brand promise of the company. And he said, no, we didn't. I said, yes, you did. He goes, no, we didn't. I said, yes, you did. This is my freaking show, so I'm going to get the last word. So, yes, you did. So I said, basically, the brand promise of the company was you cared more about getting us the box than what was in the box. Remember? What was their brand statement? 30 minutes or it's free. Exactly. And now they're saying they care more about what's in the box than the box itself. I mean, think about this, folks. How many of us have ordered Domino's pizza? Come on. Yeah, all right, for those of you who aren't making eye contact, I know you did, okay? And what we called Domino's, right? So like tonight, we don't have time, we didn't have a lot of time, so we would get home, we're gonna pick up the phone, we're gonna call Domino's, we're gonna order some pizzas, and what was the first thing we did? We looked at our watch, hoping they would be late so we would get a free shitty pizza. Right? Basically, that was the brand promise of the company, right? Not only did we want a shitty pizza, we wanted shitty service to get the shitty pizza. It's like playing the lottery. We're hoping, hey, I'll put my money down. If they're late, I get the money down, and I get a crappy pizza in return. This is, God bless America, right? And they changed it. They basically, they changed the whole premise. And what was, they challenged themselves. They said, we're going to change. And they admitted, and they were radically transparent in advertising it to everybody. And by being honest, by being transparent, by causing tension, their stock went overnight from 70 cents to over $80. They almost ran out of pepperoni. Risk. When I was at Kodak, we were in one of the biggest fights in business history. Most of you will know about it. We decided at Kodak to get into the inkjet printing business. You remember this? We were up against a company that made $9 billion. $9 billion last year in profit off of inkjet cartridges. Ink! Basically, I can't tell you their name, okay? Because of legal reasons, but their model is notoriously decadent, okay? I just like to refer to them as Big Ink, Okay? This is, Big Ink's motto is basically take the printer off the shelf for free and give it to you. And then the inkjet cartridges are locked up behind the counter. You know what I'm saying? Kind of like, here's the crack pipe, okay? Now at Kodak, we decided that what we would do is charge a fair price for the printer and half price for the ink, and we'd still make a killing, okay? That was our motto, okay? And we would go up to the high burners. I'll get into that in just a second. So here we are up against these guys. Think, I want ink. I was watching the news last night. They're talking about the price of oil. Bullshit. Talk about the price of ink. Do you know what's more expensive than oil per ounce? Ink. I'll get to it. This is called the buildup, okay? Now, some of you got it right now in front of you. Bottled water's more expensive per ounce than oil. You know what's more expensive than bottled water? I get paid for this shit, okay? Now, not today. And I'm glad for it. More expensive than bottled water. Some of you had it this morning. Vodka, yes, vodka. You know what's more expensive than vodka per ounce if you had a great year? Champagne. You know what's more expensive than champagne and vodka and you had too much of it? You might need it. Life-saving penicillin. You had penicillin, champagne, vodka, bottled water, and oil times 10. Ink. $9 billion they made off of ink last year. You know, Katie was talking about when oil prices were down, it wasn't too good. But you remember when they were high and it cost you $4 a gallon for gas? You remember that? A lot of people, you guys were happy going, oh, this is really good, this is really good. But the rest of us are going, this is bullshit, this is not right. You know, it would cost you for a 20-gallon tank, $80 to fill up. I'd be going like this, or if you had a pickup truck like me, $150. This is like crap. This is hot. This is a lot. Do you know what it would cost you to fill up your tank with ink from Big Ink? Come on. $1,500, not even close. $10,000, not even close. $462,000. Now at Kodak, we were only going to charge you half that, okay? Because we cared about you, okay? So here we are in this big fight against Big Ink. And and I said, look, what we got to do is poke them in the eye. Because if we poke them in the eye, then they got to talk about pricey ink and how pricey ink stinks. And we're going after high burners. And high burners are those people that use 4 to 8 times more inkjet cartridges than the normal user. So that means we'd move to profitability a lot faster. I didn't want everybody. I just want the high burners. So we would target the high burners. This is what we're going to do. So I said, hey, why don't we do a mobile campaign? Because no one's doing one of those yet. And we'll get people to text us. And they'll watch a commercial. And we'll put a commercial in front of the motion picture theaters. And in front of pictures and motion films. And we'll put it in front of the films because that's where the high burners, they like creatives. They like to watch movies. This will be great. They'll see the movie. They'll text us. And then they'll get 50% off for price ink. Okay, so we're in this fight against Big Ink. I'll give you their initials, HP. Okay, now. Causing tension. You got all those people in your company, they're gonna tell you not to go to the front of the stage where it's scary. They're gonna make you try to drive you back here. You know that? You know who they are in the company, HR, you know. Legal, those sneaky bastards, okay? That's not, your job is to become the chief tension officer. Please, put this on your business card. They have a saying in sports, no pain, no? Pain. Then why don't we have tension in business? We should be causing tension. Tension's great. When you talk about those things that are transparent, when you talk about those things that are obvious, when you talk about the things that are differences between us, we somehow come together by causing the tension. I love debate. And as much as I deplore what our president is doing half the time, by God, at least he's doing it. And the reason why I like he's doing it, because the rest of us are going to get off our ass and change it. One way or the other. Yeah. There's like half the audience right now going, I don't like what he said about Trump. He had me till Trump. Get over it. causing, I'd say the same thing when I talked to the president last week, okay? Act presidential. And stay the hell off of Twitter. Unless he tweets HERWorld17, then we're okay. Yeah, why don't we all like, hey, Trump, where you at? HERWorld17, right now. Always do that. Okay, what the hell was I talking about? Risk. So, I hired Vinny Pastore. You remember Vinny Pastore? He played Big Pussy on The Sopranos. Because who better to show the decadence of the model? Here was the commercial. He pulls up into the East River on the docks outside of New York in a black Lincoln Continental. He gets out of the Continental. He's wearing a black leather coat, carrying a baseball bat. He walks over to the trunk, opens up the trunk, looks inside at what you think's a body. He looks down at it. Camera shots looking up at him. He says, "You've been lying to us. You've been cheating us. You've been robbing us blind." The family says, "You've got to go." And then we show a picture of an HP inkjet printer in the trunk. He takes the printer out, puts it on the ground, beats it with a baseball bat. Puts a chain around it with a cement block, and he throws it into the East River. He gets back in the car, he puts his arm around a Kodak printer, and he says, "Welcome to the family." We sent that out, nationwide campaign. That Monday morning, I went looking for the results of that campaign. Team came walking in. We spent millions of dollars. They had a sheet of paper slid across my desk. I pick it up, I look at it. The number of texts that we got over the weekend. Two. I said, 2 million? They go, "No, Jeff, two." I can tell you right now, that's not a good ROI. Right? So I turned back to the team. I said, "Get everybody together." We got to everybody together in a room. 30 people. I said, "Somebody please explain to me what the hell went wrong with this campaign. Why? What was wrong?" Finally, someone raised their hand in the back of the room and said, "Jeff, what do you do when you walk into a motion picture theater with your phone?" "Turn it off." I said, "Where the hell were you when we came up with this idea?" Team wasn't practicing radical transparency. People knew that, but were afraid to speak up and look at what it cost us. We changed the campaign, turned it around, grew the business by 1,427%. You have to take risk. I turned to the team and said, "No one's going to die." No one died. Let me leave you with this one last brief story. When I was in college in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, a small little Lutheran school called Augustana College, my job on campus was to take care of the speakers that would come in for the lecture circuit. It's a great job. Speakers like Margaret Thatcher, Ambassador Andrew Young, Mikhail Gorbachev, Elie Wiesel, Ralph Nader. I picked up Ralph Nader at the airport in a 1976 Ford Pinto. For those of you who are laughing and you got a young person next to you who's not, please explain that at the break. And then I had a speaker by the name of Jacques Cousteau. You remember Jacques Cousteau? Yes. On Sunday nights, when I was a kid growing up, we used to watch The Wonderful World of Disney, followed by Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom. Then followed by The Undersea Adventures of Jacques Cousteau, my hero. I was the oldest in my family, so I was allowed to stay up and watch that show while my brothers and sisters had to go to bed. I would sit 6 inches from the front of the TV set on the floor with a red stocking cap on my hat, and I would watch these undersea adventures and watch my hero. And here I was having dinner with him the night before he was speaking on our college campus, and he started regaling me with story after story, and he told me about this one time he was down deep underwater, about 130 feet. Well, if you know anything about diving, you know that's extremely dangerous. And when you come up, you must come up in stages or you'll get what they call the bends. It's the most very painful thing of the air molecules expanding in your bloodstream, feeling like they're going to explode. And if you live, it's the most painful thing you'll ever experience in your life. He looked at his watch. It was time for him to come up. As he came up out of the cave, equipment not being what it is, he hit the top of the cave with his underwater breathing apparatus, and it tore a little hole, and what little air he had shot out like a rocket. And in that split second, he knew the only chance he had to survive, the only chance he had to live, was to swim as hard and fast as he could, knowing in his brain, the experienced diver that he is, he's going to get the bends. Even if they get him to a decompression chamber, it's going to be painful. He might not even live, but it's a chance. And he takes off and he starts swimming as fast as he can. Out of nowhere, someone stops him underwater, turns him around. It's one of his swimming buddies. And he turns him, and he turns to Jacques, and he grabs his air mouthpiece, and he shoves it into Jacques, and Jacques breathes, and they make their way up in stages. And as I was sitting there having dinner with him that night, I turned to him, I said, Mr. Cousteau, aren't you scared? Aren't you petrified? You could have died. And he turned to me, and he said, Jeffrey, one should never be scared when you're in good company. Look around you in this organization, in the things that you can do together. You are in great company, and don't forget it. Thank you very much for having me.
Jeffrey. We have one question from Milan.
Yeah.
We wanted to see, Jennifer has it for you, if we could just get you to answer this one question from Milan. Her.
We'll do questions at the next day.
Okay.
We'll do it then. How's that?
Okay.
We'll do questions later. Is that okay?
Okay, so Milan, stand by. We're going to get to your question later. So we haven't forgot about you, Milan. Thank you so much, Jeffrey. Woo! That was awesome.